Thanks for coming, everybody. My name is Chad Mitchell. It says that I'm a security architect. I'm not a security architect manager. I manage all the security architects, but nevertheless, that was not too long ago that that happened. So thanks for coming in today. We're gonna be talking about safe reference architectures. Anybody ever heard of safe reference architectures from Cisco? Couple of hands, okay. All right, so we're gonna talk about safe reference architectures and how, you know, a couple of guys within Cisco, we started to use it to kind of break down things like NIST 800.207, TIC 3.0, and really kind of any kind of strategy or mission that you're trying to achieve. And me working for a vendor, you know, obviously I'd love for you to buy all Cisco stuff or whatever it may be, but I realized that that's not the reality, right? So we need to stop looking at it as products and look at more solutions or capabilities, more capabilities than anything. So that's how we're going to actually try and break this down for you today. So let's go ahead. Standard disclaimer, I'll go ahead and skip over that one. All right, so I got a couple numbers up here. Anybody know what these numbers might be from? Probably not, right? Anybody ever had a package shipped or delivered to their house? Everybody, right? So these numbers are actually from a study that was done by UPS. And what UPS did was they changed processes, right? And by doing that, they did 20 million less miles, 350,000 more packages, and 20,000 tons less metric waste. Anybody know what the process was that they might have changed? 100%. Bingo. All they did was change their process. Nothing changed about how many packages they had in their trucks. Nothing changed about their trucks. All they did was they said, I'm gonna make right turns whenever possible. Their routes might have been longer for some of the routes that they were on, but the only thing they did was change to making right turns only, no lefts. So what I hope to, you know, bestow upon you today is that how looking at changing processes of how you assess what the mission is or what the outcome that you're trying to achieve is and how you actually get to, I want to achieve that outcome by doing X, Y, Z. And it may be with products that you already have in your environment, licenses that you need to add, capabilities that you need to turn on, and integrations that you may need to turn on, making products work together more efficiently to increase your security efficacy, et cetera, all right? So I wanna start off with giving you kind of a baseline of why we came up with the need for safe reference architecture. SAFE isn't an acronym, even though it's all capitals. It actually used to be an acronym, but it no longer is. It used to be security architectures for enterprise, but now it's for anything, not just for enterprise customers. It can be for anything. You know, what is the architecture, and then how we're gonna use it for NIST 800.207, TIC 3.0, and kind of any kind of mission that you're trying to achieve, all right? So, why we came up with SAFE, or why we started to look at breaking things down into capabilities and building out architectures and designs based on best practice, is that our networks have changed significantly. Anybody remember these networks? Real simple, right? I just had a switch and a router, and I could talk to the bank. I didn't have to have anything in between. I didn't have to go across any big networks, anything along those lines. Then we got a little bit more complex, right? Then we added things like wireless networking, mobility, cell phones, et cetera. And then, you know, we added IoT. The complexity has since gotten bigger and bigger. We've added more things, more hops, more technology into the mix, and the complexity has gotten big. And then when we look at security, that's now our attack surface, right? So when we look at architecting solutions, I used to do post-sales for a long time of, you know, deploying solutions within customer environments. We would figure out, okay, where's the most effective point to put our security product to make the most impact or to protect the most number of endpoints, et cetera, et cetera. The reality is that when we look at, you know, mobility and work from home and everything, that security solution needs to be anywhere and everywhere, right? And it may be a combination of multiple products working together, but really what we're trying to achieve the mission with is the capabilities, and we'll get into that. So how do we get there? you know, everybody spells security differently. This is the way I like to spell it. You know, sometimes it's spelled secrety, because spell check failed on us, but you know, no organization is exactly the same, right? I talk about risk profiles and risk tolerance all the time. Because when we look at security and we look at how different companies are implementing their security, it all depends on what their risk and what their risk tolerance is. A banking customer is going to be very different than a retail store company or somebody who's selling cupcakes online, right? All of those things matter into how we are going to actually apply our security within the environment. And I'm sure there's some government people in here. That last bullet point, governance and executive orders, always fun to put deadlines on stuff. The other thing that we talk about is hyper-focus on prevention versus reaction. Anybody heard of the gumball model? Hard and crunchy on the outside, soft and gooey in the center. I forget what the Tootsie Pops, right? Or the castle model, right? We have the moat around our castle. That's what gives us our security. We're preventing anything from getting in. We're not actually focusing on how we're going to react when that Trojan horse rolls across the bridge, right? So vendors such as the one I work for, such as the one many of you may work for, sell solutions for threats, but not for every single threat, right? So we have to rely on integrations. We have to rely on multiple things. I used to have the big chart of all the different vendors that sold security solutions, cyberspace, or I forget the company that does it, but hundreds of different vendors that sell different solutions for different capabilities or different threats that they're trying to prevent. And we did some studies a few years ago when we looked at the number of tools organizations are running or the number of security solutions implemented in an environment. When we looked at large enterprises, even federal government, I cover U.S. public sector, 130 tools was about the average of tools that were in a single network environment of a large enterprise or a large network environment, right? So when you start to think about that, we bring up the security effectiveness gap. As you implement more capabilities, your complexity goes up, your effectiveness or your capabilities go out longitudinally, right? So we want to try and reduce that gap. So as we implement more tools, we want our capabilities to kind of rise with that instead of kind of flatlining, right? And that really comes down to identifying capabilities, integrations, and putting them all in a flow or in a business process and understanding how we can use the tools that we have to reduce that gap. I've said integration a few times. I don't know if I coined this term, but I like to call it silos of excellence. A lot of tools, including ones I sell, have these silos of excellence in a lot of cases. And by silos of excellence, I mean that they do really great at the threat that they're meant to prevent, but they don't have that grain transfer tube between the different silos to share the information or share the data that they have about what they're doing with the other tools in the environment to make those other tools more effective and make themselves more effective. There's a lot of things that are happening around APIs and specific integration languages that are happening out there, like DXL, PXGrid, and so forth. But one of the examples I talk about when I think about silos of excellence is I was working with a large government network where talking between two different entities of the customer had to go all the way up to basically a border router and then come back down, right? Because they wanted to segment those two different entities very well. Well, in that process, they were going through about 6 firewalls and IPSs and IDSs. Well, you can imagine the latency that adds, right? As well as if they didn't operate in silos of excellence, they would be able to share, I've already inspected this traffic. No need to inspect it 5 more times as it's going to the destination, right? So making our systems operate better, not duplicating efforts and increasing complexity and trying to figure out where the problem is, right? When we have that many solutions in that traffic path, we don't know where the problem may lie, right? So our mission is to get to an integrated architecture. So with the integrated architecture, when I spin one of those cogs of the diagram here, everything else spins according to how much the size of the wheel, right, or the size of the gear. And that may be how much security or influence it has within the environment. But that's the goal. And so how we're going to get there is, again, looking at capabilities, all right? So I want to go through high-level safe reference architecture. This is what we call the key to the safe, all right? I'm looking at the next slide. Security-centric methodology focuses on risks, threats, and capabilities. You guys heard me say that 10 times already at least. And then architectural guidance using capabilities and validated designs. All right. So when we look at the capabilities, one of the main things that we do as part of the Safe Reference Architecture is identify where gaps may exist. And when we get into the TIC 3.0 and 800.207, you'll kind of see where those capabilities that are required or recommended within the environment are laid out for us. So we can actually start to say, I have that one, I have that one, I don't have that one. And it's very easy to identify gaps. With other architectures like Zero Trust, it may not be as clear cut, and you'll kind of see how I kind of modified that. But then we apply that to our places in the network. And you'll see how I use places in the network with 800.207. All right. So key to safe, places in the network are things like your branch, your cloud, your edge, your data center, et cetera. And then capabilities kind of fall into those different domains that you see, whether it's a compliance capability, security intelligence management, et cetera. So we use all of these things in combination, in concert to achieve the architecture or the reference architecture that we want to deploy for our environment or your environment, right? Based on what you have, what you need to get, gaps that you identify, et cetera. So this is only a 50-minute session, I think it is. I couldn't go through all three sections of SAFE for you. We're gonna focus on number one. There is a link in the deck that goes to the full SAFE reference architecture overview that covers sections 2 and 3. But I think that this is the most basic way of looking at it, right? And this is, when we think about you guys leaving out of here with something to apply within your environment, is how do I look at what I have, what I need, and then find my gaps and figure out how to achieve the mission I'm trying to do, all right? So in step one, business flows define the attack surface, capabilities secure the attack surface. So what are capabilities? Capabilities are functions rather than product, all right? So anybody know what this icon is? Commonly used for? Firewall, yeah, pretty simple. So the capability is that I need the capability to firewall my network or segment my network with a firewall, all right? So when we break down into capabilities, there's a whole alphabet of capabilities. Don't read everything up there, this is for reference only, but there's all kinds of different capabilities out there. From firewall to IPS to DNS security and malware sandboxing and so forth. So when you look at each of the things that your tools can do, each of those things are capabilities, whether it's licensed or unlicensed or whatever. If the tool can do it, it's a capability of that tool. So now that we know how baseline of what capabilities are, let's look at the business flows, because this is where we're going to apply the capabilities to the business flows. And this is where you start to break down in a safe architecture workshop that I do with customers from time to time, where we go in and say, what are your critical business flows? Do you run a web service? Do you have banking applications? Do you do point of sale information and so forth? So business flows are basically you have a subject and a resource, and it could be any human, any device, any network, any application. How do we break that down even more? Let's look at a really simple one. I have someone who needs to process credit card data. Anybody want to, say that they do that, PCI, et cetera, PCI DSS and so forth. But this is our basic business flow. I have a clerk that wants to process credit card data. Well, if I break that down even further and say, okay, I now have a human that I need to identify who they are. I need to assess the status of their device that they're using to process that credit card data. I need to look at what tools I have within the environment on the network, whether it's a VPN, whether the network can be even Starbucks Wi-Fi going to a cloud service that has these capabilities in it, all right? And then I have an application security layer, right? So whether it's a host-based security system, et cetera, all of these things are capabilities. So when you start to break it out even further, you start to look at all the different business flows that you have within your environment, you can start to see how you can identify, I have these specific capabilities within my environment, how can I apply them to each of my business flows? Making sense so far? Good. So as I said, 2 and 3, we're gonna go into the actual nitty gritty of TIC 3.0 and 800.207 now, but there's more information there on the overview of SAFE if that's something of interest for you. So who's familiar with TIC 3.0 or Trusted Internet Connections? Good, okay, a couple hands. This is a method for government agencies to connect to the internet, right? Think points of presence. If you guys remember the old TLA stacks from the DoD days, this is a security stack for government agencies and so forth to get to the internet, and how we're going to secure the traffic going inbound and outbound of that particular agency. All right. So what is TIC 3.0? It's exactly kind of what I just said. The big difference between and why 3.0 came out is that the guidance adopts a less prescriptive tone. So this was something that came up immediately when they started talking about TIC 3.0. Many of my customers were calling and saying, well, what do I need to do? And I went right back to that risk policy or risk profile and risk tolerance, right? What is your risk profile? What's your risk tolerance? Because the reality is that under TIC 3.0, it's based off of that. If your risk profile is very low or your tolerance is very high, the capabilities that you implement are not described for you or prescriptive in saying that you must do X, Y, and Z, because the reality is within the federal agencies that adhere to TIC 3.0, they range from very small, 15 people, two or three offices, all the way up to internationally based organizations and agencies, right? So the goal here was to make it able to change and be able to mold to what the customer actually needed to do and provide guidance, not a to the letter, you must do X, Y, Z. All right. So funny story about this slide. I spent a lot of time on the phone with Sean Connolly over the last couple of years. I actually presented this slide to him. So I'm sure it was probably weird for him to see his own quote in a slide being presented to him. But nevertheless, this talks more about the use cases of the business flows, right? Agencies need to understand the flows and the coming in or going to their systems, and not just from their employees, but from anyone, the public, et cetera, and anywhere, cloud, system to system, et cetera. So, this really kind of highlights the need to understand the business flows and then how we're going to apply the capabilities to it. I can't confirm or deny this, but these little dots showed up on these diagrams in the CISO architecture after I showed them the safe reference architecture mapping. I don't know if that's was implied or not, but the concept of putting policy enforcement points in the traffic path between the subject and the resource is the way that they actually lay it out in the guidance that they provide, right? They also have these concepts of trust zones, right? Going from a high trust zone to a low trust zone. When we look at zero trust and you apply it to this kind of methodology, the trust zone is always red, right? No, there is no trust zone. Right, but within federal agencies, sometimes there is a little bit of higher trust within an environment that has high physical security, et cetera. But nevertheless, again, applying and looking at the use case or the business flow between a client and a server and applying the security policy or the capabilities based on that flow. Now, TIC 3.0 was very generous to us when we were looking at it and the reference architecture that they gave us the capabilities that they were looking for. Right, they gave us the capabilities that were available to their customers to use within the architecture. And there's three different capabilities that they laid out. There's universal capabilities, there's traditional and branch capabilities. So universal capabilities apply broadly. So basically every solution that you apply within the environment should have these capabilities. And they're pretty basic ones. Least privilege, configuration management, use services, and this is the big one, right? I said integration about 17 times now, so shared services is a great way to use integration to security intelligence or information about the environment, identity, IDAM, PAM, etc. So they also had the traditional TIC capabilities. Traditional TIC was your concept of I have a point of presence that exists in a data center. 1, 2, 3 of them, et cetera, for high availability, et cetera, and so on. But they laid out, again, the capabilities. I didn't put all of them up here or else it would be very, very hard for you to read. But nevertheless, very simple, basic stuff that they think about when they look at the traditional TIC. And then when they talked about the branch, they added two more, network access control and IP blacklisting. Now, what we did from there is we said, okay, here's the capabilities that they're looking for. What are the products that they may have or already have or looking at procuring? And we said, what can that product do? Or what can that solution do? What can it integrate with? What can it talk to? You know, what shared services can it leverage, et cetera? And we started laying it out like this on a single line, or you know, as you see it here, where I have a next generation firewall that has all these capabilities. All right? So we now lay out and we look at, here's the product list that I have, I've already bought and own. Whether I have a license for it or not, let's ignore that right off the bat. This is what my solutions can do. Then we started to lay it out into the business flows. Now this is a little bit of an eye chart, I understand. But we started to say, okay, I have a user over here, I have a resource over here, and it's gonna go through all of these steps or all of these security tools across a WAN to get to this resource. And this is where we started to lay out and say, okay, how much, what's your risk profile, what's your risk tolerance, how much of this capability do you need based on your environment and based on the requirements that you're trying to achieve. So you can see how you can start to lay out different products that you may have or solutions that you may have. And I even drew these blue arrows in here. Anybody have any ideas what those blue arrows might indicate? Integrations or shared data, right? So you know, it's not comprehensive, but you know, the sandbox being able to tell the firewall or the web proxy that, hey, this file was bad after I ran it through the sandbox, so I need to actually start blocking it now, and I need to actually reach out to my endpoint EDR system and quarantine that file and undo anything it might have done in the last 15 minutes, right? So all of those things working together in concert gets us to that reaction phase instead of the prevention phase, right, that we talked about earlier. And then you can get even more complex. Again, another eye chart, but you know, as a user goes to a web resource, trusted application, untrusted application, they may take different routes. They may go across a WAN circuit through a traditional TIC for some applications, but go across a straight broadband internet to get to a web-based application. When we think about user experience, we want to try to express route as much of that stuff right to the closest data center and so forth. Well, when we look at TIC 3.0, we started to say, okay, well, if we're going to start allowing that, and we're not going to force everything to go through a traditional TIC, we're not going to force the boomerang of VPNs, where I have to VPN into a head end and go right back out to the internet out of that head end when I could have gone to AWS that's sitting over in my Seattle data center when I'm sitting right there, right? So TIC 3.0 enabled that for these customers, and the way it enabled it is for them to say, if I'm going to those services, I can apply these capabilities. And those capabilities within that use case or within that business flow meet my risk profile and my risk tolerance for my users accessing that application. So again, breaking down the capabilities and not necessarily the products gives us the ability to start looking at things a little bit differently. Make sense on TIC 3.0? Fantastic. So this is gonna be a little bit of a different way of looking at it. I've said capabilities a million times. I'm gonna look at it from a solution perspective. Right, because the other way that we can look at this is that when we look at 800.207 and the CISA Zero Trust model, the capabilities aren't necessarily as well defined as they are with the TIC 3.0 architecture. I mean, literally, if you go look at those documents that I linked, tables of this is the capability, this is what it must do, yada yada yada. Right? When we look at 800.207 and we look at, all the things that have come, Zero Trust, Carta, ZTX, Beyond Corp, et cetera, it's a little bit different. So we're gonna look at it a little bit different way. So with that said, this is a redraw that I worked with a couple of guys on my team of the 800.207. Again, don't read everything on here. The big one to understand here, no implicit trust, right? We talked about that a little bit. The network is not actually always trusted. And then there's a subject and there's a resource. And then in that flow is the policy enforcement point, all right? And that policy enforcement point can be any of those capabilities that we talked about across any solution in any way, shape, and order that we want to put them in. There's a key thing to understand when we look at 800.207 and some of the discussion I've had with the folks at NIST and so forth, is that when we look at a policy decision point and enforcement point, the reality is that can exist anywhere in that traffic flow. When we look at the network being not trusted, you could say that it's not going to be a network security solution. The reality is that it could still be a network security solution, all right? You would say that, you know, there's probably a good case for it to be on the endpoint, or probably a really good case for it to be on the application that I'm trying to protect, or both, and in the network. I add them all together, you know, all the capabilities going together, but that policy enforcement point can slide back and forth anywhere. So if we go back a slide, it doesn't have to exist right here between the network and the application, right? It can exist anywhere in that flow, right? So anybody familiar with the zero trust pillars? Whether there's 3, 7, 5, 10, who knows? I like 5. 5's a good even number for me, even though it's actually odd. But identities, devices, network, applications, data, all right? There are some foundational items that we'll cover in a minute here, but those are the key 5 pillars that I like to talk about when I talk about zero trust. And you'll see those 5 across, you know, all the permutations of whether it's 7 or 10, et cetera. But these pillars of zero trust, what I try to do here is we start to look at, okay, I have pillars of zero trust, and then I have where am I going to implement my solutions within my environment? And then at the bottom, you see security operations, and that gets back to that foundational item that I talked about. So let's break it down as best as we can into capability alignment, all right? When we look at capability alignment in those different categories, I have things like multi-factor authentication, EDR, network segmentation, application or workload policy, data loss prevention, and so forth, all right? So this is probably the closest thing I could get to when you think about, I have these different groups of places in the network that I want to protect. These are the capabilities that apply to those different ones. There's obviously more than what's up here. But then what I wanted to do from there is say, okay, I understand 802.7. I have a subject and I have a resource. I know my 5 pillars of the CISA zero trust model. Let's look at it all together. All right. So now I have my subject and my resource. I have my 5 pillars. I have my different places in the network that I may apply my security. And then across the entire thing, I have this foundation of visibility analytics, security intelligence, threat response, and you know, all of those different solutions or capabilities or tools or whatever you want to call it are receiving or feeding data in up and down across as traffic goes from the subject to the resource, all right? To break that down even a little bit more, let's look at this. So when we start to look at, okay, I want to look at my zero trust infrastructure, I want to identify what solutions I have for identity, devices, network, applications, and data, then I start breaking it down and I say, okay, here's what I have, right? Not necessarily capability, it could be solution. You could do capabilities in here as well. You could say, hey, I've got MFA, I've got, you know, EDR, I've got all of these different capabilities. Start to put them into the columns that they exist within, all right? Now, again, look at this from the perspective of what you can do with the solutions you have or what you can do with the gap solution that you're looking to procure. And then from here, what I decided to show you guys today is that we use the same business flow methodology. And we say, okay, I have this subject that's going to this resource. What would be the security tools the capabilities that would apply to that particular flow? And when you look at your environment, the business flows and kind of the concept that I think of with business flows when I talk to my customers is that the business flow, anybody familiar with like service insertion and that capability of, you know, I want to put this in line only when this is happening and so forth. That's how your tools can work within your environment as well. Based on how your different business flows, your different security solutions are going to interoperate with that traffic in a different way. So you start to break down your business flows. And I didn't put an exact, payment card system or, you know, but this is really just a generic, I have a subject who's going to this application, and within, you know, this user being part of certain identity group or certain, place in the network or certain device status and so forth, I may handle that traffic differently and send it through more rigorous inspection or more lightweight inspection. You know, this is kind of showing them coming across a VPN. So they're using a secure client, then going through an IPS. Well, maybe this is someone who's not using a VPN, so they would go straight to like SASE, right? You can start to break down and say, okay, based on the different flows, what solutions and capabilities am I going to use within that environment? Now, to pull all that back to CISA and Zero Trust and maturity model, once you've kind of identified your business flows and how you're going to have your different solutions and capabilities interact with those flows, it really helps you with building out that maturity model, all right? So this is the CISA Zero Trust 5 pillars. My joke is, why is the foundation at the top? But nevertheless, you can see the things like visibility, automation, governance are really the foundations and really things that stretch across the entire environment. But we take those 5 pillars and we break them down into maturity, right? Because you can have identity. Your identity has been username and password for how long? Right? A very long time. But it's not very secure. It's not, it's not optimal. So what CISA did is they published a maturity model breakout that gives you kind of different stages of where you can be. And what we tried to do with this is to break it down again, even into the layout of the 5 pillars and the Zero Trust architecture that we kind of talked about, and start looking at, okay, based on that flow that we just did with the line drawing going through, well, how was I doing their authentication to that secure client? What level of inspection was I doing on that traffic as it was coming through? What posture was I doing on that endpoint? And I could start to overlay and say, okay, we did password-based, MFA-based authentication, so that's pretty traditional. But then when they hit that VPN head end, we did some sort of posture assessment, and we made a decision based on their compliance at that particular time as to what level of access they got to the network. Somewhat advanced. Once they got that level of access to the network, we did some segmentation. We set up some basic network analytics, started collecting the data of what they're communicating on the network. Also, again, somewhat advanced. We didn't just let them connect and then, freedom, go wherever you want. Then when they got to the application, we did authenticate them at that application. And then on the actual data that we're reaching, we do have encryption there for them to be able to, or for the data to be kept secure. So you can start to see how you can identify by doing those business flows and then breaking down exactly what you did in those business flows, how mature your solution is within that environment. Another thing that we did, we started to break it out, and again, I'm a US public sector guy, into a Pentagon, right? So you wanna start stretching that yellow line out to those outside edges to achieve the most optimal result within the environment. So, how do I apply this, or how do you guys apply this within your environment? Hopefully it resonated that you should go figure out and make a list of all the solutions that you have and the capabilities that they have and how those map to the mission that you're trying to achieve. Hopefully that resonated. That's number one, right? Identify inventory of the solutions that you have and capabilities that they have. But number one is identifying the flows of traffic that are important to you, important to your organization, whether it's retail, online shopping, payment card systems, etc. Once we've done those two things, we can start to look at what are the required capabilities for the mission that we're trying to do. Whether it's a mandate framework like 800.207, and then start aligning them. Just like that next generation firewall. Here are the capabilities that my next generation firewall can do. Start checking them off on the mission that you're trying to achieve. From there, you can identify the gaps and identify whether you need to procure something new, whether you need to procure a license on an existing product that you already have, or whether you need to do an integration between two products that you already have. All of those things can close those gaps. And then finally, implement those solutions where needed. And then steps 2 and 3 kind of go into a little bit more detail of actually documenting the architecture and looking at the best practices for different types of places in the network, et cetera. So with that, I am going to end. I think we left about 15 minutes for 15 minutes, right? Okay. Yeah, for Q&A, if you guys have any. If you do have a question, I am hard of hearing, so if you want to step up to the mic or I can come down to you so you don't have to go backwards. But go ahead.
I have a loud voice, but I'll go ahead and use the mic so for the recording. How would you apply different risk assessment methodologies, let's say, like the NIST CSF framework risk assessment, to get a current state and also to determine maturity models, and how would you integrate that with things like data classification models to determine where you need to be, your target reference models? If you get what I'm saying, you do an assessment,
yep,
and then figure out, based on the type of data you're handling and the different business process, to me it would seem like it would tie into your BIA and your data classification projects. That would tell you the type of capabilities you need for the different business processes.
Yeah, so your risk assessment is going to help you identify your risk profile and your tolerance, right? You're going to identify your critical systems. You're going to identify the data that you may have that needs to be highly protected versus not, right? Once you do that, I think that helps you understand the business flows that you need to focus on for implementation and identifying gap, right? We always used to say you can't protect what you can't see. If you don't know what the risk of your environment is, and that's where your risk assessment methodology comes into play, if you don't know what systems you need to protect more than the others, then you don't want to apply these principles just generically to every system in your environment, right? So I think that that's going to help you with identifying the business flows that you want to focus on first. I think that answered your question, right? Okay. Any other questions? Or does everybody want an extra 10 minutes before their next session? Oh, you got one? All right.
Yeah, from a measurement, a maturity measurement perspective, okay, you have zero trust, CSF.
I'm sorry, I can barely hear you.
Oh, okay. From how to measure the maturity of these frameworks, because we have zero trust, CSF, tech tree. Like instead of like having, you need to create three groups. Each group need to track, how mature each one. Is there a mapping or alignment?
How to measure the effectiveness of each of the tools, kind of?
Yes. Yeah. Instead of measuring three framework, is there a mapping between the three? So it only measure one and it show you a maturity across the other frameworks.
As far as measuring effectiveness of the capabilities in implementing towards the process that you're trying to achieve, that's going to come down to tabletop exercises, risk assessments, as the other gentleman mentioned, even potential, taking the employee hat off and putting the bad guy hat on, and identifying, okay, if I was to attack this particular business flow, how would I do it? And then try to achieve that, and then identify where you may have fell short in the implementation of what you already have. Sometimes that might be something good to start off with. If you already have a pretty robust security environment in place, go off and start doing an assessment from do some gray hat or some initial assessment or initial breach attempts to identify how effective is my security environment now, then start breaking down the capabilities and doing the mappings in that way. Does that answer kind of the question? Let me come down to you. Uh-huh. Yeah, the CIS controls, yeah. There are mapping between the frameworks.
Yeah, I did a lot of.
Okay, yeah.
There are a lot of different mapping tools out there. There's CIST and NIST and NIST Assist. There's NIST to ISO 27001. And I've also just recently purchased a software tool to help me do this. But otherwise, you're going to get giant spreadsheets. been laying out to apply. ISACA has their maturity model. If you buy their tool, it's outrageously expensive. You could basically do the same thing. One is there is no process, five is process mature. So you can either do an on-off on your control assessments, or more applicably, assign a 1 to 5 type maturity rating based on a scale. And there are, if you just Google it, you'll find people out that have done all sorts of different cross mappings. It's just a pain then to manually cross.
Yeah, there's always overlap between the different frameworks and models that you're looking at, right? So there are mappings out there from the industry side. I know from the vendor side, we do a lot of mappings to different, 853 and so forth. And obviously I didn't put all just the product names on there, but nevertheless, if you're looking for mappings from framework to framework, there certainly are some options out there already. It's a general framework, completely vendor agnostic too. We may have developed it and wrote it all up, but when I do safe reference architecture workshops for customers, I go in from the point of an advisor, not from the point of a salesperson, right? It's looking at, again, I know the customer environment. There are places that my company doesn't even play. So I know that my customer isn't going to have 100% my vendor's product, right? So the reality is that very rare do you find a customer that has everything from one vendor. So we go in with we take the Cisco hat off and we say, what do you have? What are the business flows that you're trying to achieve? And then we try to say, okay, here are the gaps. Now when we say here are the gaps, obviously we're salespeople. Yes, we can talk about the products that fit into that we offer. But nevertheless, it does provide a generic architecture for any type of environment. Mm-hmm. Yep.
So they want to implement a zero trust based environment for the solution.
Mm-hmm.
So they can adapt to your safe framework and tether their solution around the safe. And the safe is a distributed reference framework.
Yep. So there are solutions that fit into each of the different scenarios, right? I think one of the things that we find a lot when customers look at the safe reference architecture is that a lot of times solutions get deployed for one use case or another, and then almost sometimes forgotten about when another use case comes up, right? And when you start to break down things like we kind of did today, especially when you do it in a workshop with the network operations, security operations, CIO, CISO, et cetera, involved in kind of that process, what happens a lot of times is that they say, wait, you already have something that does that? Well, how can we architect our environment in a more efficient way to leverage the same tool for multiple use cases to be more efficient, right? So, yeah. Anyone else? Going once, going twice. End a meeting for all. Thank you. Thank you all.